take a step back. Cause it's only a step back. Your name is Rick?
Yep.
Los toman por su
ya me dijeron que me puedo comprar yo. Pero ya cargan cuando yo voy a tomar.
Es que es un poco.
If I can make a statement in English, so very briefly, so what we have here is we have a scooter. He has two individuals, Adele Cotton and Ever Cotton. I have copies of the complaint that I can make available to you. If you leave a card, I'll get it to you. These individuals were tax preparers who were retained by Mr. Marquez. They received $2.3 million in fraudulent tax refund checks. They were monies due and owing by the IRS to Mr. Marquez. Mr. Zuazo can speak to the particularities. These were monies that were retained as sports earnings and that were subject to repayment based on the filing of return for 2008-2012 by Mr. Marquez. One check that was sold in 2018 was the amount of $898,057. The 2012 refund check was $1,410,382. These checks were sent directly to the home of the Cottons and were deposited at the Chase Bank across the street at 13103 East Philadelphia Street, Whittier, California. This account was opened in violation of Section 326 of the Patriot Act, which requires that all banks have a customer identification program, or CIP. A bank account cannot be opened without positive identification of the account holder. What happened here is the Cottons went in with a power of attorney that was forged that Mr. Marquez had no knowledge of, opened the account, and were able to process and steal $2.3 million of the account. How the account was opened without managerial approval, we don't know. We intend to find out. We filed a complaint with 17 causes of action. I won't bore you with them, but they're essentially fraud cause of action and breach of fiduciary duty against the bank and the individuals. Both individuals are currently incarcerated and serving time in federal prison in an unrelated $250 million tax refund fraud case. All this information in the public record, copy of the complaint can be pulled. The case number is LA Superior Court case number BC655284. Anyone that wants a copy can leave a name or a card. I will email you a copy of the complaints, which I have here. It was filed on March 24th. I intend to amend this complaint to include a RICO cause of action for racketeering, and I will be serving the complaint on Chase and the other individuals named, including the two Cotton co-conspirators who were involved in another IRS action where 55 individuals were indicted and several pled guilty. One employee of U.S. Bank pled guilty as well. Actually, he'll be pleading guilty in May. An investigation into the matter is still in progress. Next step of litigation, I'm going to file an amended complaint, serve the complaint, and continue the investigation. Finally, we ask that if there's any members of the public who have any information about any fake accounts being opened at Chase or any stealing of tax refund checks from Chase, to please come forward and contact me. My name is Alan Romero. I'm an attorney in my law office in Pasadena. This is definitely, if you think, a threat to public safety, people opening accounts under other people's names, stealing their, it's identity theft, stealing funds for money, and potentially these accounts could be used for criminal activity. We think it's a threat to public safety, and that's why we're having this press conference here. To our Spanish media invitees, you're welcome to ask questions to me in Spanish. I'll have to respond in English for clarity. English language media, of course, will answer in English. I think Mr. Marquez has some statements, and after that, we'll take questions. Thank you.
Si hay alguna pregunta o algo, ¿qué hacemos?
Bueno, la voz de Juan Manuel, fue migrante en Cerrero, de Foxeo con Cerreros Encinas. Juan Manuel, en pocas palabras ahí para la gente, para que la gente se dé cuenta, que definas un poco, desmenuce un poquito el caso que estás presentando.
Primero, muy saludarlos, buenos días a la gente que está presente, al abogado Alan Romero, a Cipié, Noriel Suazo, Francisco Arce y su servidor. Estamos aquí por el caso que ya le están comentando, por el fraude que se me cometió a mi persona, prácticamente el contador, o en este caso el papá e hijo, hicieron algo que, pues, algo que con el sudor de mi frente, con esfuerzo, con dedicación, con mucho trabajo, lo hicimos. Me defraudaron con dos cheques de gobierno, abrieron cuentas, tan sencillo para abrir una cuenta en un banco en Estados Unidos, sin papeles, sin firmas, que son, con firmas que son falsas. Muchas cosas en cuestiones que pues yo creo que un banco tiene que tener mucho cuidado en poder abrir una cuenta, y la verdad que sí estoy muy agraviado y estoy como agredido a la situación, y estoy pues muy enojado por lo que está aconteciendo. Me gustaría estar en una conferencia de prensa para una pelea, pero ahora no es así. Ahora tenemos una pelea, pero con la situación que me está pasando, con la situación económica que pues está agrediendo a mi persona y a mi familia. Así que es por eso esta conferencia en prensa, el cual pues prácticamente un fraude de una cantidad importante, que nosotros lo ganamos arriesgando la vida, subiendo al cuadrilátero, entrenando fuerte, y que unas personas con nada más mover un dedo puedan abrir una cuenta y puedan hacer cuestiones de dinero tan fácilmente. Pues la verdad que sí estoy muy, muy apenado y a la verdad muy enojado.
¿Qué cantidad aproximadamente fue y cómo fue que procedieron? ¿Cómo fue que abusaron de tu confianza? ¿Cómo tuvieron acceso y en qué parte el banco entra a ser culpable?
La cantidad exactamente son 2.3 millones con cheques de cheques federales, cheques de impuestos, los cuales yo ingresé. Yo mandaba mis gastos al contador. El contador se fue ganando mi confianza, me regresó. Yo no había hecho mis impuestos. Yo pagué mis impuestos desde el 2006 al 2012. Nunca había hecho yo la cuestión contable, nunca había hecho yo, no había metido yo mis gastos. Así que los decidí meter, y muchos amigos me recomendaron al que se hizo pasar por CPA, a Adel Cotton, y a su hijo también, Heber Cotton, me lo recomendaron. Ellos se ganan mi confianza regresándome tres cheques de mis impuestos, pero después se roban, poderlo así decir, literalmente se roban dos cheques, y ellos no sé cómo, de qué manera pudieron depositarlos, cómo firmaron, con qué documentos, cómo hicieron para poder abrir una cuenta en un banco que ya ustedes saben cuál es, y la verdad que eso me da mucho coraje. Y con el esfuerzo, como les digo, con el esfuerzo que uno hace día a día, el pararse a entrenar, arriesgar la vida en el ring, estas personas con solo mover un dedo, en este caso el papá e hijo, pero también lo más preocupante es cómo llegar a una institución bancaria tan fuerte como el banco que ustedes saben, y poder abrir una cuenta y poderlo hacerlo tan fácilmente. Voy a decir el nombre, Chase Bank, y la verdad que estoy muy, muy, muy apenado y, como les digo, muy, muy enojado por la situación.
Porque ellos tuvieron que haber presentado identificación de usted, o sea...
Claro, tuvieron que haber presentado, bueno, no presentó una identificación, hubiese estado yo presente. Nadie puede abrir una cuenta si no estoy yo presente, que no tenga documentos originales. Así que la verdad que eso Para mí es mucho, mucho coraje, indignante poder hacer esto. O sea, yo me puedo parar una institución bancaria y poder sacar dinero, no se puede. Ellos no sé cómo lo hicieron, pero bueno, aquí tenemos una cuestión que es importante que el abogado va a analizar.
Alan, did he get his money back? And how did you guys find out about this?
Well, if I may answer the first question, the last one, it was in Spanish. How was the account open? The account was open with a durable power of attorney. It was forged. The signature down here, it says Juan Manuel Marquez Mendez, which is not a legal name that's used. My understanding is under the Patriot Act imposed customer identification program policies, which all banks must have, you must identify the account holder. After that, the power of attorney can be used to operate and make transactions from the account. So essentially what happened here is they walked in with the power of attorney. They may or may not have had a co-conspirator inside the bank who overrode company policy and federal law to open the account and used a very poorly forged, with a possibly forged notarial seal to open account and override the customer identification policy and then make large transfers of cash, wire transfers to different people. And we're still in the process of investigating. I'm sorry, sir, could you please repeat your question?
Were you able to get the money back, and how did you find out about this?
Well, first, did we get the money back? No, I think we got $600 back. I think Mr. Arce was able to get $600 back out of $2.3 million. That's in great. Terms of how we found out about it, I think Mr. Zuasso, the CPA, can speak more clearly to that.
Around the time in March of 2015, Mr. Marquez, which is the dates are on the complaints, but Mr. Marquez came to me saying, hey, I haven't received a couple of these refund checks. So, you know, we said, well, let's check it. It's actually very easy for us, an accountant or CPA, to look into a client's refund. You just get a power of attorney from Mr. Marquez and he signed it. Then we called and the IRS got account transcripts for 2008 and 2012, which was checks that he didn't have yet. So we got the transcripts and it showed that he actually had, the IRS had paid those checks out to him. And so that's when it kind of all started, because we said, wait a second, Mr. Marquez says he doesn't have those checks, but the IRS says they did get paid. So there's another procedure that the IRS has that we can actually look into what happened to a refund. We can file a form which requests that the check is either lost, stolen, or didn't know what happened, and they will do a quick investigation to see what happened with those checks. So we filed that form, and the IRS sent back not only a letter, but also a couple of the actual canceled checks from the bank. And they said basically, hey, we paid these checks out to an institution with Mr. Marquez's name on it, and also the bank sealed, proving that the bank paid those refunds. And so that's kind of how it all kind of came about. And then they directed us to look into the banking institution to see what happened with those refund checks. And that's kind of where the investigation started. Yep, and those are the checks right there.
Ahí en medio nomás, aquí en medio. Gracias. Gracias.
So these are the two checks in question. One check was issued, and this one's a bit blurry. This is I believe a 2008 refund check in the amount of $898,000. This one's a bit blurry. Get a better copy for everyone. This one's very clear. This is I can read it from behind. It's a $1.4 million tax refund check for the year of 2012. The address here, I won't give the house number. It's Joan Drive in Hacienda Heights, which is an address where Adele Cotton, the defendant, lived, who's also indicted, currently serving federal prison time as part of a $250 million tax fraud. So these checks, the bank accounts were open. The checks were sent to the home of the purported accountant, and they were deposited, and several transfers, both in cash, wire transfers, and by other methodologies were made. So I was asked by some of the media, do you have problems of proof here? And I believe I see the young lady shouldn't say that. See, the journalist here asked me that question. And I said, no, the checks were mailed to their house. They went, they used a fraudulent power of attorney to open the account, and they stole everything except for $600 that they had left there. So that's where we're at. Yes, ma'am.
¿Puedo decir en español, por favorcito?
Yes, por favor.
Ese pedazo de... ¿Qué es lo que tú quieres? ¿Qué es lo que quieres este, con esta demanda? ¿Qué es lo que estás pidiendo?
Mira, lo que se está pidiendo, lo que se está pidiendo con la demanda es este, pues que se repare el daño, que se repare el daño cuestión propia, cuestión familiar, que se repare el daño. Lo que se quiere aquí con la ayuda del abogado y con toda la gente que está con el CPA, con toda la gente que está envuelta en este caso, que se repare el daño hacia mi persona, hacia mi familia, porque incluso hay veces que estoy entrenando y esta situación no me deja hacer lo que tengo que hacer yo. Me ha dañado, ¿por qué no decirlo así, mentalmente y por qué no decirlo también físicamente en la cuestión de que no puedo entrenar como debe de ser? El estar pensando, el estar enojado, eso no me ayuda a seguir adelante con mi carrera, así que lo que quiero es que se repare el daño y que se vaya donde se tenga que ir, hasta las últimas consecuencias con la ayuda del abogado.
And I would just like to add also what I would like to see happen is there be stricter controls, investigation of these fake accounts to ensure there's not the risk of public safety where individuals who may seek to harm citizens of the United States are able to open fake accounts and put millions of dollars in and potentially put our public at risk, which is one of the reasons we're having this press conference.
Sí.
Ok, la pregunta es la siguiente. O sea, un simple cheque de $1,000 por parte del IRS te exigen y te lo ponen en juego. ¿Cómo es posible que esto haya pasado en Chase, según su experiencia, y cuál es su consejo a la gente? ¿Cuál es su consejo a la comunidad?
Bueno, ¿cómo puede pasar? Pues como ya el abogado ya como que ya dijo lo que puede pasar si alguien falsifica los documentos, pueden abrir una cuenta y usar ese nombre para cambiar los cheques. Entonces eso es lo que yo creo que pasó aquí, pero aparte de, digo, para la comunidad, que nomás que se fijen en los contadores que ellos escogen para hacer sus impuestos, que se fijen en todo eso y que escojan bien. O sea, de lado de eso la comunidad.
¿Usted considera que fue una parte irresponsable por parte de BAC o de Chase en no exigir?
No exigir documentos, sí. Eso es lo que miramos. Porque en la carta que el IRS le mandó al señor Marquez y nosotros estaba diciendo que allí que vayamos al banco y revisemos con ellos. Porque ellos son los que le cobraron el cheque o dejaron cobrar. Pues aquí están los cheques. Estaba hablando a el abogado. Aquí está este y aquí está este. Y aquí esta firmas y esta ni tiene firma. Es nomás cuenta que depositaron. Entonces,
¿sabes de algo? Cuando el hijo, pues con todo respeto, es un estúpido, o sea, la mera verdad, no sabe nada de esto. Yo lo traté y vi que no sabía nada, el inteligente era su papá, el cabeza era su papá. Entonces ahí es donde me di cuenta y empecé a dudar, pero tenía una manera, una facilidad de mentir. Yo le llegué con pruebas en las manos y le hacía primero las preguntas y me las negaba. Y yo viendo así, trayendo las pruebas, decía, le creía. No puede ser, digo, que me engañe tan fácilmente trayendo las pruebas en mi mano. Es una persona bastante astuta y por eso logró hacer lo que hizo.
I'd like to translate actually very important points made by Mr. Arce. So I believe what Mr. Arce initially said was that apparently while this account was open, Mr. Adelcott, who was a ringleader, was under house arrest on an unrelated tax fraud case. There were three cases. So when he opened the account, Mr. Arce understands that the older Adele Cotton was allowed to leave the house for a few hours on Fridays to do shopping and to go to do grocery shopping with his doctors. So he opened this account with an ankle bracelet on for another federal tax fraud case. There were two other tax fraud cases, and it's just something that's a lot of concern to Mr. Arce and to Mr. Marquez, that someone walked in, who was under indictment, I can say I did investigate the backgrounds of both. My specialty, I'm an attorney. I'm also a certified fraud examiner. I do primarily financial fraud cases and forensic accounting cases. So this is something I see a lot. It's someone who is a sociopathic liar and is very good at getting business, covering up their lies, and stealing money. I researched Adele Cotton's father. I could not find any record of him being an IRS enrolled agent or a California licensed tax preparer. The son, Heber Cotton, I believe I did find was a California licensed tax preparer. So the stories, there are stories that he traveled to Tokyo as an international tax expert, were apparently all part of a fraudulent artifice to defraud and to gain the trust and confidence of Mr. Marquez and his manager, his financial manager, Mr. Arce, in order to effectuate this this fraud and this crime.
I don't know if this was already covered, but it's something I talked to you about Thursday or Friday. But how did Mr. Marquez come to meet the Cottons, and how did this business deal get set up?
Well, I discussed it. I do have an answer for you. I think I'll let Mr. Marquez answer, then I will translate for you.
Okay.
So, la pregunta es, ¿cómo conocieron los señores Cotton?
Nosotros, yo conocí a los señores Cotton porque me lo recomendaron unos peleadores que habían hecho impuestos con ellos, amigos que también me hablaron bien.
Legal violations, restitution, and violation of California's unfair competition law, which is Business Professions Code 17200. So we have gone after them with all we have, and in addition, I will be filing an amended complaint to include racketeering causes of action.
So basically, you'll be suing Chase and the CPAs all together in one case, or?
That's actually a great question. So what I've done in this case is, as we don't know exactly what has happened or what's transpired, so we allege based on information and belief in California courts. So I've sued J.P. Morgan Chase & Company, which is a Delaware corporation, J.P. Morgan Chase Bank N.A., which is a New York corporation, Adele Cotton, and he has five to 20 aliases he uses, as most people who do this do, Heber Cotton, and Brian D. Lallement, which is L-A-L-L-E-M-E-N-T, who is the notary who claimed his book was stolen. He doesn't know what happened. As far as we're concerned, our initial position is that all of them acted in concert together. So every cause of action that we've alleged so far, and with investigation, we may amend, we may dismiss. But at this point, every cause of action is planned jointly and severally as against.
Settling, what did they want to do?
In my experience, corporations, and it's actually very proven, I would advise them to do the same thing, is they make no comment based on pending litigation. And I did not get that response. I had several reporters, for example, the Courthouse News Service, the first one that jumped in on this. I believe Ms. Baird was here, got the same response. They're not going to comment on this litigation for any purpose. So are they going to try and fix this? I would assume not. And I would assume they're going to deny liability. But again, those are assumptions. But I've had no communication with them yet. I do need to amend, which I will do in the next couple weeks, and then I will be serving the complaint on all the parties, and that'll be the operative complaint at that time.
Is there a date already set up for trial, or are you looking at that? How far are you?
We're just, again, a good question. Sometimes I get ahead of myself. So we've just filed the complaint. The next step would be to serve the complaint. We haven't done that yet because I'm going to amend the complaint. After I serve the complaint, they're going to file a response pleading, which is either an answer or something called a demur, which you don't need to get into. And at that point, either they're going to try and get out of the case or they're going to be in the case. Same thing for the Cottons, okay, and the notary. So then at that point, it will go to a trial. It will go to a case management conference and trial sitting conference in the Los Angeles Superior Court. And at that point, the judge will set a trial date in the future. Discovery, which is basically written investigation, will commence. And at some point, probably 12 to 14 months, based on my experience in the Superior Court with their trial calendaring, we're going to have a trial date on this. Well, I think mostly it's going to be a RICO cause of action, so I am going to allege that there were predicate acts, certainly a violation of it was 326 of the USA Patriot Act, in addition to other, I think I listed 28 statutory violations or breach of fiduciary duty, and use of the mails to essentially to have committed this act and to have siphoned off these funds. Additionally, I'm going to add some more information to shore up my venue and jurisdiction so we stay in Superior Court. And I think additional information will be, I may discuss further the fact that this was not a regular account, because a regular account holder, there's no fiduciary duty. They can do whatever they want to you and essentially have a breach of contract. However, the account that was open was so large, it was a private banking account. Private banking includes investment advice, trust advice, wealth management, and as a result, there's a higher level of standard and there's fiduciary duty, and I think I may extrapolate a little bit more on that issue. Well,
me tocas, me venía yo aquí a Estados Unidos por la seguridad, para no estar en mi país, que lo amo mucho, que lo quiero, y es un país que la verdad que extraño, pero sí, yo quería venirme a vivir para acá, pero mira, a ver, la cuestión ahora me rematan también aquí, entonces es difícil poder tomar una decisión, es difícil poder estar tranquilo, tanto en México como aquí en Estados Unidos, pero bueno, pues va a buscar la forma, se está buscando la forma para poder estar tranquilos con el abogado Alan Romero y con todo el equipo que está aquí presente. Vamos a buscar la forma de estar tranquilos y que todo trabaje como debe de ser, con calma, en paz, y que la gente no pierda la confianza en ninguna institución bancaria.
¿Has pensado en cambiar de banco o de asesor?
No, yo tengo cuentas nada más en dos bancos, Bank of America y en Wells Fargo. Nunca yo he abierto una cuenta en Chase. Ahorita me sorprendieron con que yo abrí una cuenta en Chase, pues, prácticamente imposible. Entonces, yo tengo cuidado y tengo gente en Wells Fargo que maneja mi cuenta personalmente conmigo. Que, por ejemplo, si hago un cheque, la gente del banco me habla a mí por teléfono. ¿Usted giró un cheque de tal cantidad, a tal fecha? Digo, sí, yo lo hice. Pero bueno, yo ya tengo un control en mi cuenta. Yo en esta situación, en esta cuenta que abrieron de Chase, yo no sabía, hasta que me enteré por medio de Francisco Arce. Me sorprendieron. Hoy abrieron cuentas a tu nombre, con firmas, con documentos. La verdad, prácticamente yo sorprendido, que tuve que venir a darme cuenta de esta situación. Entonces, la verdad que es muy apenante y muy preocupante este punto.
¿Cómo cambia tu pensamiento, Juan Manuel Márquez, ante la deficiencia que ha habido en México? Y como también se ve en este lado, que somos un poquito endebles todavía en este rubro.
¿Cómo cambia? Pues en la cuestión de que tiene que tomarse más cartas en el asunto para poder arreglar estos puntos, tener más cuidado en todos los aspectos, revisar documentos bien, documentos que sean originales. Es más, ¿para qué vamos a darle tanta vuelta al asunto? El que quiera abrir una cuenta, que lo haga personalmente, que esté la persona presente para poder abrir una cuenta, no si tan fácilmente con poderes, con los power attorney y cuestiones así. Tiene que estar uno presente para poderlo hacer.
If I may, actually some very important points. The initial question was like, Mr. Marquez, if you had lost some property under similar circumstances in Mexico, and Mr. Marquez responded, yes, it happened to me and it hurt me a lot, and that's why I came here to the United States and I work here and I fought here and I do stuff on ESPN, for example. And it was very disappointing to him, the fact that the same thing that happened to him in Mexico has now happened to him again, the type of corruption, which I'm Mexican-American as well. My family are political refugees, fought in the Mexican Revolution, came here in the 50s during some of the nationalization. It's not my press conference, but anyways, unfortunately, I love Mexico, you know, it's my blood, it's where home feels, but unfortunately, it's having some growing pains, a lot of corruption right now. And so both myself and Mr. Marquez are disappointed that we came here, and the same type of corruption you would see in another country is being seen here. And Mr. Marquez said he came here for calm and safety, as a lot of Mexican immigrants do, or people that come here to spend some time here or work here. And then the next question, and that didn't happen. The next question was, has he considered changing banks? And the response was that Mr. Marquez has never had any business relationship whatsoever with Chase Bank. He has bank accounts at other banks, which I won't say which ones, but that he's never been with Chase, and he didn't even know he had a Chase account until he got a call and said, there's the refund checks went to Chase Bank and they're endorsing Chase Bank. What the heck's going on? And Mr. Marquez said he's seen a lot of consternation, and the fact that he would like to see, as part of the outcome of this, that banks take better care to protect their customers' identities. As I discussed earlier, the customer identification program, that is more forcefully enforced to ensure this type of thing doesn't happen, not just to people like Mr. Marquez or other Mexican people who have come to this country looking for a better future, a more secure, less corrupt banking and business environment, but to anyone who doesn't have the same brand name as Mr. Marquez, who aren't as fortunate. We all hope that those people benefit from us taking this action against Chase Bank.
Francisco,
So there you have it. Another great video for ES News. For ESNewsReporting.com, I'm Ellie Secback reporting. And you can follow me on Twitter at Secback. And you can follow me on Instagram at Ellie Secback.